Today is December 10th, 2020. I'm a Common Sense, and welcome to the Black Men's Book Club. Whoever you are, wherever you may be, and however you may be listening, thank you for showing up today. I appreciate you. And today, I am not alone. Thank goodness I got Mr. D back with me. How you doing, Mr. D?
Oh, I'm good. I'm glad to be back, too.
Oh, my goodness.
How did things go?
It was all right. It was all right. It was much harder than I thought it would be without you.
Well, we'll have to bump fists when the COVID thing is
right. It was much harder. It was much harder than I thought it would be. And I managed to get an hour out of it.
Oh, good.
Yeah, I managed to get an hour, almost an hour, 57 minutes. But have you listened to it?
No, not yet. No.
Okay. What I did was I decided to cover the history of the labor movement through a black lens.
I'm anxious to listen to it now. I think during the week I'll take a listen.
It's something because what I found was we have some jobs that are considered skills today, union jobs like carpentry and bricklaying and painting.
Right.
And during slavery, those were Negro jobs that white people would not do.
Yes.
But then directly after slavery, unions were formed to steal that work from black people.
Yes.
So I talk about that and then I kind of talk about how it all changed.
Naturally.
Right.
You know, that's been the road to many middle class families, you know, home purchasing, school, insurance policies that get paid when people pass on, you know, all financed through middle class jobs. And a lot of those jobs are union jobs.
Right. And then I got into the New Deal. You were talking about, you know, purchasing housing and whatnot. And a lot of that history is wrapped up in the New Deal.
For sure.
Yeah. So
and the returning veterans.
I didn't get into the returning veterans so much. Oh, okay. But I did tie that episode into our voting episodes and how we were talking about how the labor shortage was caused by World War I, which led to the Great Migration and people fighting over work, and it all wrapped up into one nice neat little bundle.
So you went from what year to what year?
I brought it from about right at the end of slavery, starting around 1865-ish, and I brought it all the way to current, really. Well, I kind of did that same 100-year stretch from the end of slavery until the civil rights movement.
Right, right.
Because that's when we see the labor start to become more friendly to black people. It's right around the time of the civil rights movement, because the AFL and the CIO formed in 1955. And then they were instrumental in the passing of the Voting Rights Act and the civil rights movement in 64 and 65.
Yes.
Right. Yeah. So I got into that history, but I don't want to necessarily go backwards. That was last week. So if you all missed that one, by all means, go back and listen to it. It was a pretty good run.
Yeah, and there's a lot of situations, events, and other things which have impact on us today, you know, for better or worse.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah. So I think it's worth listening to. I certainly am going to listen, but I think our listening audience needs to listen and, learn what they can from that, because you kind of got to know your history in order to be able to plot where your present is. And then if you can look forward from that into the future, you know, in basic mathematics, they talk about 3 points. Make a straight line.
Mm-hmm.
See, not two, three, right. Because the one of those points is a check on the other two. You see, so past, present, and future, as human beings, you know, we're able to get some idea of where the heck we going.
Oh no, come on, black people have a past. You guys are just in Africa waiting for white people to come and civilize you. Stop it. Okay. So this month, our book of the month was post-traumatic stress. Post-traumatic slave syndrome by Dr. Joy DeGruy. And we will be transitioning out of that book this episode and transitioning into our next book, which for next month will be Destruction of a Black Civilization by Chancellor Williams. So we're going to effectively say our parting words on post-traumatic slave syndrome today.
Parting with great sorrow.
Right.
This book has been a tremendous eye-opener for me. I may have approached it, oh boy, slavery, I don't want to think about it, because my eye is on the future, trying to deal with, family and situations that I find myself in currently. But it's been quite an eye-opener for me, and I've been listening and reading, and the more I read it, the more I learn. You know, this is a tremendous book. Everyone who hears our voice should tell 10 people to be able to get this book and read it, because it's a tremendous work. I mean, I think of it as being a classic now.
I do too. I agree with you 100%. I think Dr. Joy put a ton of research and work into this book, and it's the type of book that after you read it, you should pass it off to the next person. Don't even, if you can't afford to buy it for them, pass it to them, gift it to them, because this is information that we all should be privy to.
Hey, what do you say if we invite people after they get the book and they read it, and they dwell on it and contemplate it, and talk with their family and their friends about it, maybe they can write in.
Oh, I encourage that.
Yeah,
I encourage that. And see, what I wanted to do, the way I wanted to structure this entire show, and I can't due to COVID, is everyone that we've talked to about this book, I wanted to have them back and have a big group discussion. So earlier we met Dre Khan, right?
Yep.
I wanted to have him back to talk about this book. I also wanted to have Big John back, because those were our two guests while we were covering this book. But I don't want to have a whole bunch of people in one room due to COVID, So maybe next month, or actually, I don't know when we're going to have another semblance of normal. So it will not be next month, but eventually that's how we'll be running this, is whatever guests we talk to throughout the month about the book, they'll come back with us at the end of the month and have a bigger group discussion about, and we'll all say our parting words.
Yeah. I think that's a good idea.
But in the meantime, if you've read it, you have something you want to tell us, what did you get out of it? How did it affect you? How did it change you? Do you see things in yourself that are written in the book, right? Because I'm telling you, I read this book and I seen myself all over this book, all over it.
Well, I did too. Yeah.
Growing up in Los Angeles through the gang banging era.
Yeah.
I was the guy in the good part of this book.
Yeah.
Growing up, and it took me a lot of education to reinvent myself.
I didn't identify with it in quite that same way, because of my own background, thank God. Thank my parents and so forth. People that I've met along the way.
Right.
But nonetheless, the whole concept of trauma and the recognition of what trauma is, and the length of time that Black people have had to adjust, maybe even suffer. Well, not even maybe even suffer. Let me say it the other way around. Black people have had to suffer, right, and maybe adjust,
right,
to the trauma, untreated trauma. You see, like recognition of the fact that we got some things that we do. We don't even know why we do them.
Yeah, we just think it's the way things are.
Yeah, and it, to some degree, we identify our Blackness through the trauma that has happened. But we got to realize that trauma needs to be cured.
Yeah.
It's not a healthy situation for people to be in.
It's absolutely not.
Yeah.
And it eats on itself. It grows, yes, on itself. And yes, every generation that deals with it passes it down to the next.
Now, you said a mouthful there, brother.
Social learning theory, baby. All right. Well, before we get into all that, let's do a feel good. Let's do a feel good. You got a feel good story for me?
On the way over here, I was thinking about quite a few things. The usual, I woke up this morning and I'm glad to be alive, and my car's working, and
right.
People are flying by me. I'm just taking it easy to save gas, And I was thinking about some political stuff. But more important than the political stuff, I was thinking about something that my daughter did, and that made me feel like it's going to be all right. See, I am hearing from the news announcements, that some of Biden's team, and, you know, I kind of get the sense of, like, they're thoughtful and they kind of, you know, they're making sense to me, not like the other people, mm-hmm. you know. I'm glad to see that the media is spending less time on the other people. you know what I mean? And I'm getting a sense of, well, you know, these guys may not be able to fix it all up because it's really blanked up, you know.
Right.
You know, but they're thinking about it and they're overcoming the obstacles and they're putting a lot of thinking and planning into it. And that makes me feel like not depending on them, but certainly let them do their job.
Right.
You know, that's why they're there, you know, and we need to stay on top of them. And that's a segue into what my daughter did, because, you know, I did a protest and I had a sign. You know, my other daughter, let her know. And so my daughter took a screenshot, you know, of me mm-hmm. with the sign. And, you know, what the sign says, been there, done that.
Got the T-shirt.
Yeah. You know, it's like all the young folks well, aren't you going to get out and vote? I said, no, man, I got a granddaughter to think about. You know, I got.
You mean vote or protest?
A protest.
Oh, yeah.
You know, my thing is, like, I got to do some things with my family as I'm getting older. You know, while
right.
I can.
Right.
You know? And so that's the main purpose in the life. I've been through the protests about 4 or 5 times.
Right.
You know, so I got a different perspective. But they kind of got in my head when they, you know, well, you need to be out here too. You know, Black Lives Matter and all this. And they do. I mean, that's where we start at. So on my sign, when I had to write on the sign, I said, been there, done that. And then I said, protest, because that's an important part of it. They got the active voice right now.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? They need to continue to do that. Now, the messaging, I think, you know, can be adjusted. I'm going to say adjusted, you know, but I'm glad they're doing it because I'm not doing it now. See, I've already done it before, you know. And then the second part of it was, protest and then vote. See, like, as far as asking somebody to help us to do something, voting is one of the ways that can occur. You know, I'm not going to say it's easy to do because, you know, it's too involved. You know, voter suppression, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. There's about 10 different things that have been attempted to try to minimize our vote in our community. But voting is a piece of it, you see. So protest, vote. And then I extended it to boycott. You know, that's the economic part. Right. You know, realize that your dollars are like votes. Except you vote many, many times. You don't just do it every once, every 2 or 4 or 6 years.
Right.
See? So how we spend our money is important. And we have many people that have told us that in the past. That's a lesson we can learn. But even I have learned something. And that is that we got to lobby. And I use the word lobby to indicate that we got to be up in these fools' faces. You know, we got to be telling them what I want. And I got an axe to grind with our community. As much as I love them, and I want to see them do better. I think our community lays over too quick. You know, they're too accepting of too many things. And there's lots of other people coming into our community. You know, and they have a right to come on wherever, but we can't go into their community.
Absolutely not.
You know, I think back to New York where the Italians would come into the Black community, but the Black community couldn't go into the Italian community.
Right.
You see?
Right. Are you talking about just as far as physically going into the community? Okay, okay.
You know, business-wise.
Right.
You know, you don't need to be talking to people because this ain't your neighborhood.
Right, right.
You know what I mean? And they'll, you know.
But that's always been the case.
Yes. So here we are as Blacks who so frequently are accepting. And actually, that's one of our virtues. That may be one of the reasons why we've been able to survive so long. You know, but we got to be in a position where we are demanding more. We are, and I'm using the word demand as in French for demander.
Mm-hmm.
You see, like asking,
right?
Constantly asking. We got to tell people. We got to ask people, but we got to tell them what I want so that they just don't roll over us anymore.
I agree with that, but. The only thing I take issue with is the word asking, and the reason that I take issue with that word is because. if someone has all of the power, then they have no reason to give you anything that you ask for. So at some point, you have to take it.
Well, I did say, you know what I mean? It's just like a soft pedal, you know what
right,
I mean?
Right, right. I get it.
But you're right. I understand that too. Like, we need to stop, you know, asking, you know, and but at the same time, we need to be asking. And I think that's why I use the word tell,
right.
You know, it doesn't end with the election.
You know, it doesn't.
We need to be in the offices of all these elected officials. You know, we need to be telling what we want for our community. And, you know, the game is I vote for you. You represent me and some of my interests. And then they make those interests happen. Indeed. And if they don't do it, then they don't get voted on for, against.
Right.
You know, again. So the idea is that there's a two-way street that's going on. And I think that would take care of a lot of the misrepresentation that I'm going to say both parties, you know, the Republican Party has done some things and then done some other things.
Right.
The Democratic Party has done some things and then done some other things. And we need to hold them accountable.
I agree. And they don't seem to have any teeth. So we really need to hold them accountable.
Yeah.
We really do. I agree with that 100%. I have a feel good.
What is that?
So my little guy, my son just turned 5 years old, and I went out and I bought about $350 worth of Nerf guns.
Nerf guns?
Nerf guns, right? Because my son, well, my kids, okay. All my kids, they love Fortnite.
Oh my goodness!
Yeah, right. So I said, well, we haven't had any exercise in a while, and. And, you know, Fortnite's fun, so let's play Fortnite in real life.
Outside?
No, in the house.
Oh, in the house, okay.
In the house.
Okay.
So,
oh, I can see that now. That's just like fun.
It was great. I got home. They thought that, I kind of set it up so that I took a few of the guns to work with me.
Yeah.
It was a Monday, and they were thinking that they were going to be able to ambush me when I walked in the house, not knowing that I came in the house locked and loaded, ready to go.
Okay.
Picking kids off. Boom, boom, boom.
Surprise, surprise.
Right. Now, what I didn't expect was that Nerf gun fight was going to last for 4 hours.
Oh, this is a great story.
It's great until...
this is really feeling good.
Until you find yourself sweating, you know, stuck in the corner of your room getting shot at by 13 Nerf guns. It's great. I mean, and you know, here's the problem, though. I think I made a mistake because every single day since that day, I've walked into my house and at some point I've turned around and seen a Nerf gun pointed directly at my face with some snot-nosed kid looking at me like, hey, daddy.
Yes.
Hey, daddy, I'm going to shoot you.
Yeah, I'm going to get you.
I'm going to get you. Hey, come on. Don't point it at my face. Now, our Nerf gun fight was great. Everything was swell until the point where I shot my wife in the eye.
Oh, now that was not supposed to happen.
No, it wasn't. It wasn't. And here's the thing.
There's a lesson in that.
I would never, ever, ever intentionally shoot anybody in the face or the eye or anything. But these Nerf guns, now, we've seen they have the long bullets, right?
Yes, I've seen them.
Now they have these little balls. They're about 1 inch in diameter, foam balls, and they move.
Uh-huh.
They move. I think it's, depending on the gun you have, you can get them somewhere between 90 and 120 feet per second.
Wow, that is fast.
Yeah, it's fast.
You know, indoors, that's really fast.
And she was shooting at me. Uh-huh. She was shooting at me, but she was kind of ducked down behind the couch.
Mm-hmm.
And so she only had her gun pointing up and her eyes pointing up right over the gun. And so I'm kind of aiming and I was aiming for the gun.
Uh-huh.
And I shot and I was shooting the gun. Boom, boom. I shot it like 3 times. And then that one last one, I shot it and the trajectory of the bullet kind of wobbled a little bit. It kind of wobbled and I watched it and it went right around the barrel of the gun and came back and hit her right in her eye.
Like slow motion.
Oh, man. Her eye was open and I'm watching her just writhing in pain. Just and, you know, I felt bad. There's nothing you can do about it at that moment. The damage is done.
Well, that's a good lesson for you guys. Sounds to me like safety glasses.
Protective equipment. Yeah. So that's what we did. We went and ordered a bunch of the actual Nerf face mask and like vest and whatnot.
Well, that made it even more fun.
Right, because the kids love it now and they want to do it every single day. So it's cool because it's a good way to get exercise.
I better not do that in my grandchildren's home because they're going to shoot me too.
Yeah.
Even the little one that's gonna like pow, 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 pow,
pow. And that's the thing. My son turned 5. We had my 4-year-old nephew was over the day that we did the Nerf gun thing. Now these Nerf guns are supposed to be for like kids 9 and up.
Right.
And the little ones, they found a way to make them work.
Yeah, yeah, you know they do.
Oh yeah, they found a way to make them work.
They do.
So that's my feel good. Did you have another one?
Well, let's leave it at that. Let's get into into the lesson, because I think the lesson in itself. The book, the chapters that we, are focusing on to try to, wrap all this up, are feel good in and of themselves.
True, true. Before we do that, I do want to get to one quick segment.
Okay.
Things we think you should know.
Okay.
All right. So I'm not going to go really deep into detail with this. I'm going to kind of just give you a couple headlines that I think are relevant and that the listeners should know about. And let's see how you react to them. So, COVID in the NFL. Have you been paying attention to this?
I haven't been paying a lot of attention, but I have been paying attention.
Oh, my God.
Yeah.
how much COVID do they have to have before they will shut that season down?
Yeah, yeah. Well, I guess, like a lot of other people, they need to make their money. I think the league is pushing them, to do it. But one is too many. Then there's 2-3 people on the team. I heard the quarterbacks, they're out sick. So they got other players playing the quarterback role.
I used to be a big, big, big time football head. Like I used to know stats because I played, I was that lived, breathed, ate football for a long time. And so I haven't watched a game since the Patriots played Atlanta in the Super Bowl about 4 years ago.
Oh.
And the reason that I haven't watched a game since then is because I refuse to believe that under any circumstances, any quarterback will come back against the number one defense in the league, 25 points in the fourth quarter. Mm-hmm. So it felt like a fix to me, and I promised myself I would never, ever watch another game.
Okay.
Right? Now, then what solidified that was the following season, all the Kaepernick stuff.
Yes.
Right? So I've been away from the NFL. I don't even know most of these players' names at this point. It's been like 4 years. But the thing that I've always said in all this time is that the NFL does not give a damn about the players or the fans.
Uh-huh.
I've said that time and time again, and this only goes to prove it. It's more than just 2 or 3 people per team. The Ravens, a third of the Ravens team is on COVID sick reserve.
Yes, yes.
A third of the team. That's ridiculous. I'm sorry. Just real quick. The Broncos went to a game the other day and basically gifted the other team the win because they started with a backup receiver.
Yes, I heard about that.
At quarterback.
Yes.
You see what I'm saying? Like, what does it take?
Well, like I said, boycott.
Right.
I mean, it gets to the point where, consumers, the people that spend the money have a lot of power, and as they exercise that power and they make choices to spend or not to spend, then, they're able to shift the dynamics of the situation. And if the NFL thinks that people are going to continue to watch, they have contracts that they got to meet, advertisers think they have an audience and so on and so forth, they're going to continue to play and in a large sense put their players at risk. But once again, Kaepernick kind of showed us, and there's been others, that if they don't like how the thing is going, as a team, they got to boycott. If they don't boycott, then, other people sitting at home, as spectators are going, well, I think I watched the game, like today,
Right.
People want, so if they think they have an audience, they're going to continue to push these guys. And if these guys continue to play, then, they're going to say, yeah, you get out in the field. I don't see the managers getting out there.
No. No.
See that? That's all. Slaves.
And that's what the it shows starting to look like the NFL is the plantation, ain't it?
So we're calling out to people, you know, make your voices be heard. There's another one, you know, like ask, demand, you know, you got to kind of state your position on things. Talk about what you like, what you don't like, and talk it to the appropriate people. If you don't want these guys to be playing, if you think it's too risky for them, then you got to tell the management that we're not going to listen. We're not going to watch. You know, we're not going to participate. You know, the audience value goes down. They're spending all that money, but they're not getting any return back from it.
Right, because
the advertisers will leave the game too.
Here's one rule to consider when you are just thinking about the way money flows. If something's being sold and you're not receiving anything, then that means you are the product.
Yeah.
You see what I'm saying? And when dealing with the NFL, you are the product. So if enough people are not watching, there's not a great enough product.
There's no product, yeah. OJ's, remember? Money, 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 money.
Right.
Money.
Show me the money. All right. So next. This is something that I have a smile on my face while I'm going to say to you. Did you know that Giuliani has COVID?
Yes. I heard about that today.
Yeah, it happened today.
Yeah.
So that dates when we're recording. For those of you who who are astute listeners, it's the 6th of December.
You know, I'm sorry that anybody has COVID, but need I say more?
No.
Giuliani has been such an asshole. I wasn't gonna curse. But really,
I should have said Giuliani.
Yeah. You know, I mean, if you heard any bits and pieces of the arguments that he's trying to put in front of the court system, well, I know how to say it. So we don't really want to waste a lot of time on him because I think he's acting like he's insane. You know.
Oh yeah.
You know, I'm sorry, but I think it's true. You know, and the judges are saying another word for insane, that is frivolous.
Uh huh.
You know, they're saying, and I think out of about 30, how many is it? 34? Is it 32? Court cases?
I thought it was 42.
42?
I thought they were almost up at the number of states by now.
Okay. Well, whatever that number is, I think all of them except for one, you know, have been adjudicated. All the rest have been thrown out because they had no merit. They were frivolous lawsuits. You know, I think the one in Pennsylvania about, well, we're 20 feet away. Well, you know, so we want to be closer. So they got closer. I think it was, what, maybe 6?
And it didn't make a difference.
No. And then they want to get closer still, you know. And then the bottom line is that it netted Biden more votes than Trump.
By 100,000.
Thank you. You know, so you and it's happened in every state. Where they just said, well, we're not even going to do all of that. You know, you guys are frivolous. I think he's saying you waste the court's time. And I'm glad to see that.
I am, too. Now, moving on to the last one before we get into the meat of our discussion today. Have you heard the name Linwood?
What, like the city of Linwood?
Oh, no. Like the attorney of Linwood.
No, I haven't.
Linwood is a Atlanta-based attorney who... he's one of the Trump side people who's still insisting that Trump won the election.
He's a loyalist.
Yeah.
Okay. That says a lot right there.
Now, mind you, he's Atlanta-based, right?
Right.
So he is pushing the MAGA crowd to skip the upcoming election on the 5th of next month.
Now, how does that serve his support for Trump?
Which is why a lot of people, it's causing a rift within the MAGA crowd in the GOP.
Well, good.
It is, yeah. It's great.
There's another good sign. But what's his rationale for that?
I mean, I can't imagine what rationale there would be for that. That you're telling people to effectively give the election to the other side.
Well, good. I like that.
I don't understand. I didn't even. It's just amazing. That's where we're at now. Is that they're so fractured that they're turning, they're imploding.
Listen, there's the thing that I've actually seen this when a ship, you know, is sinking. Mm-hmm. You know, the rats jumping the ship. Mm-hmm. That's what I see.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, and they all a lot of them look like Giuliani.
Yeah, that's why I have no empathy for him, you know.
Not at all.
You know, telling people they don't need to wear masks and all kinds of stuff like that. You know, supporting somebody where, like, the metric that I look at is how many people have died, whether you think it's real or it's not. I can't see how, was it 200 and, what's the number now, 264 now?
I don't even know. Well, I think so.
I think it's over 250,000 people. Well, let's go back to what war can you think of where that many people died? You see, it's like a war. You know, any death is a tragedy, and we have that number of people, and yet they still want to talk about you know, running for next term or passing this law or not passing that law. You know, the empathy for people who have lost loved ones, for people that are getting sick, for the lack of supplies, you know, all the economic dislocation, all the emotional stress, all the economic disaster that is, you know, happening now. These guys seem to think the only thing that's important is to continue to do whatever it is that they're doing. You fill in the blank for yourself. I have no sympathy for the man.
I don't either. This I'm looking at something right now because I was interested in what the death toll is. And this, I don't know if this is true, but it says Worldometers info. Worldometers.info has the death toll at 285,656.
Wow.
Yeah.
I can remember when it was, you know, 200,000. Right. You know, I can even remember when it was zero right. In this country. You know what? Let me say something. You just made me think of something because I heard a report and I would love to try to look into it a little bit deeper. It was on one of the TV channels. They said that the Red Cross found antibodies for COVID back in blood donations in 2019. Mm. You know, now I don't know whether that was the end or the middle or the beginning of 2019. That's the thing that strikes me. But the fact is that before vaccine came on the scene, before public awareness for the COVID thing, be it a super flu or something new or whatever the case may be, the fact that there are people that gave blood, and in that blood were antibodies, which seem to suggest
it was traveling around earlier than we knew.
Thank you.
Yeah.
There you go. I personally thank God for that, you know, and you know, it seems to indicate that some people had the ability to be able to counteract it.
Well, most people do.
Taking a virus.
Most people do. And that's the thing. It's just it only has like a 2.7% death rate or something like that.
Yes.
Most people recover from it. A lot of people have issues.
Yes.
But most people recover. But just because most people don't recover doesn't mean you will. So
right.
don't take it. Don't
mess with it.
Yeah, don't play with it. Yeah. Now, one more thing that ran across my mind before we move on to our meat of our story. Did you hear about the sinkhole that swallowed somebody up in New Jersey recently?
No.
Oh God, this is
a plain and simple. Oh, no, I haven't heard about that.
Okay, so this guy's sitting at a bus stop, right? Minding his own business, when all of a sudden he gets sucked up into a 12-foot sinkhole.
12 feet down or 12 feet across?
12 feet down.
Oh, okay.
It was full of rats. So many rats that he was afraid to scream because he thought the rats would go into his mouth. He was down there for about an hour.
Oh, this is like a horror movie.
Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, God. I don't know what I would do if I was in there.
Yeah. Yeah.
I think I'd jump out. That's what I would do.
You can't. There's nowhere to go. There's no way.
I think my energy would be so high, I would like just poof, pop out of the
Oh, bay. My God. I don't think you'd be able to.
Oh, God. I you know. So 40 minutes?
Yeah. I think it was like 45 minutes to an hour he was in there. Hmm. Just surrounded by just have rats crawling all over you.
Well, two things. The fact that that many rats were, you know, subterranean.
Right.
You know, under the sidewalk. Well, was this like near a subway?
I'm not sure. I'm not sure. But
you say sinkhole, it just like just drop.
Yeah.
But maybe it was near a sewer or something.
I don't know. It had to be near a sewer because that's usually how sinkholes form due to the moisture traveling underground that creates you know void spaces.
Yeah.
And then over time they'll sink and just drop.
I don't know what's worse, man. You know, think about the possibility of a sinkhole opening up where you think the ground is firm and then the sinkhole opens up, you know. Your car could go in there. You can go in there. The kids could go in there, you know. Thinking about the rats, you know, biting him and giving him some sort of plague type disease. Crazy. Nasty. Ugh.
Yeah, I thought you would like that one.
You know, my little baby girl, the granddaughter, she says, ew, ew.
Nasty. All right. So let's move on to our discussion for the day.
All right. Let's go.
So for today's discussion, listeners,
set it up.
Right. What we decided we were going to do is we want to cover. We can't cover the entire chapter because the last chapter of Dr. Joy's book, it's big. And what it really is, it's several smaller chapters that are all put together to form one larger chapter, which is the subject of healing.
Yeah,
from the post-traumatic slave syndrome or the things that have been handed down to us throughout the years. So, what we're going to do is Mr. D is going to pick three sections that he wants to talk about. And I picked three sections that I wanted to speak about. We don't know what each other's speaking about. So we might end up talking about the same thing. But if we do, we're definitely going to be talking about it from different perspectives. So, Mr. D, would you like to go first?
Yes.
All right.
Okay. I'm looking at the contents. And I'm looking at about, I don't know, 80 pages. Maybe 60 pages, you know, on the chapter of healing. And I tried to pick out three, but the more I read, the more I, you know, put a little note next to. So I think... I'm going to read the heading of one of them. It's on page 142. It's called Crabs in the Barrel. I don't think I really need to spend too much time talking about what that means to us as a community. We've all seen it. All you need to do is go to you know, a place where they got crabs in the barrel.
Right.
You know, and then as one crab tries to climb out, there's another crab that pulls it back in. And that's why more often than not, fishermen or, you know, crab harvesters, you know, don't really spend too much time attending to the barrel. And it makes me think about, like, why are there so many people pulling other people back? Mm-hmm. Now, instead of dealing with the problem, I kind of want to deal with some of the healing, which would suggest the solution. So there's another chapter that succeeds that. It's called A Matter of Respect. A Matter of Respect. You know, so if I were to grab one or two pages out of that, I think I'll try this one. This is the five conditions that I explored, and the I is Dr. Joy. Said the five conditions that I explored are being victimized, witnessing violence, dealing with daily urban hassles, issues of respect, and socialization. She says that she surveyed 200 black teenagers between the ages of 14 and 18. And as to part each of these conditions played in their behavior, half were incarcerated, half were not. She went on to say that while the results of my investigation surprised many of my white colleagues, to my black associates and myself, they were predictable. Listening audience, does that sound predictable? You know, the idea of, do you know someone who's been victimized, or have you been victimized? Do you know someone that has witnessed violence, or have you witnessed violence? Are you dealing with hassles? She says urban hassles, but I would extend that to economic hassles, domestic hassles, legal hassles, you know, the injustice, you know, the police. I mean, you know, we all deal with these different kind of hassles, the stresses of life. But then she talks about the issue of respect, you know, and I do think that out of all of these things, maybe the idea of respect and contemplating respect, the respect that we have for ourselves, the respect that we have for each other, our families, our communities, and so forth. You know, I do think that that might be one of the healing qualities that we're searching for as we try to wrap this book up. What do you think?
I agree. I agree 100%. And that dealing with disrespect or being disrespected is we touched on that in the former episode. You know, it ties into the same phenomena that people who witness abuse deal with, right? Because like you mentioned earlier, victims become victimizers, right? And that the aggression that people have when they feel that they've been disrespected comes from, I think, the same place.
Yes,
I think it comes from the same place.
Are you still going to talk about respect?
No, go for it.
Oh, okay. Well, let me just quote one or two more pieces on this. It said, basically to repeat, she found issues of respect to be the most significant antecedent in the explanation of violence. And she wanted to repeat that to emphasize it. The antecedent most likely to produce anger and violence in African-American male youth is, what's that word you just used? Disrespect. You see, it says the other important result of this research is that positive racial socialization, that's positive racial socialization, mitigates the feeling of anger. Now, that, I found that very interesting, that go along with being disrespected. So an African-American man who has a strong sense of himself and his history is likely to be more resilient, like, you know, you bounce back from things, you know, when he is disrespected, and less likely to respond with anger and violence. What do you think about that?
I agree with that. I feel that if a person who doesn't know himself is called a nigger, he will react aggressively because he believes somewhere inside them that it's true.
Good.
But a person who knows themselves, a person who's aware of who they are, their history, their strengths, and their weaknesses, is not likely to be affected by just a simple matter of disrespect.
Well, then let's say something that I think is important. So I kind of want to nail this down, mm-hmm. You know. She said so many things, it was just kind of hard to, like, you know, pick out one. You know what I mean? But she goes on to say that socialization, okay, so that was that fifth one, you know, socialization occurs as families provide children with a historical and cultural map of the African-American experience that describes how they have survived many adverse conditions. See, that's within the family.
Right.
You see, and I think somewhere else in my little markers here. I think, I think I might have pulled that one out too. But it says, the children learn how to believe in God, and extended family has served to strengthen and insulate them from negative effects of racism and discrimination. This will be discussed in much later detail in another chapter. So the idea of understanding how disrespect, in other words, the lack of respect for ourselves, you know, is an issue. It creates stress. It creates anger, anxiety, worry, a lot of crab in the barrel kind of stuff.
Right.
You know, but at the same time, it provides us an opportunity to be able to, raise our children.
Right.
You know, raise ourselves, help each other, build relationships, you know, with our families, whoever those families might be. And simply by treating each other with respect, we begin to mitigate all this other disrespect. And I'm not saying it's going to eliminate it, but I do think it will reduce it to a point that be much more tolerable.
I think something else that you can probably attribute to the crap in the barrel mentality is this need for Black people to feel like they're competing against each other.
Yes.
And
good point.
It's part of this competition that has certain Black people wanting to pull other Black people down, hence the crab in the barrel.
Yes.
Right. I think that a healthy approach to looking at the next Black man instead of looking at them as competition is to look at them like support.
Yes.
Right. I don't look down on my brother unless I'm looking down at him to pick him up. So the best thing I can do is stop, like I said, stop looking at people like they're competition and look at somebody else like, hey, how can I use you, but how can we use each other?
Right.
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 How can we use each other? How can we get on the same page? And how can I help you build your thing? How can you help me build my thing?
Right. 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 That makes a lot of sense.
All right. Well, I wanted. Did you have anything else to add to that one?
Well, that was this number one.
Okay. I know. Did you have anything else to add to number one?
No. Let's get to number one.
Okay.
Number two.
Okay. Well, I wanted to look at a section of the book called Modeling, right?
Oh, now isn't that interesting? Because yeah. I did read some of that too.
Yeah, and I'm not modeling. Talking about modeling, taking pictures and wearing nice clothes.
That's good.
Right?
That's good.
This is going to be a brief section on parenting. And I'm not the greatest parent in the world, but I do understand relationships with people and how to maintain them and improve them, right? So, I'm not going to read a section out of the book. Instead, I wrote something on this,
okay. But
it's relevant to the topic, right?
Jump it on us, bro.
So a simpler term for modeling might be absorbing. And I do mean absorbing like a sponge.
Ooh. Yes.
We've all heard this expression by now, but it really is true. Your children are born... We've all heard this expression by now, and it really is true that children absorb things like sponge. Now, this is my opinion right here, but I believe that your children are born with some part of their personality kind of preloaded, right? This explains how some of the behaviors that people exhibit as children might last all the way into adulthood, but the rest of what makes their personality and their character are learned behaviors that they observe while in the world. I'm very aware of this, and so I've always been sure to make sure that my kids see me doing the things that I've asked them to do. It's kind of a lead by example type of thing. When I ask my children to do something, I try my hardest to do it with them. For example, one of my daughters took up swimming at the Y. So while she was swimming in the pool, taking her classes, I was teaching my younger daughter how to swim in the pool next to them. I signed my children up for Taekwondo, and despite the fact that I was already a black belt in Taekwondo from when I lived in Korea, I started over with them again as a white belt so that they wouldn't feel any pressure. We're all now currently orange belts.
Even you.
Even me.
As a black belt.
As a black belt.
Interesting. I don't want to steal any of your thunder, but I do that you know, with my granddaughter, I do stuff.
You have to.
Yeah, and she picks up fast, man. She mimics me.
Exactly. She's modeling your behavior.
Yes.
She's modeling your behavior. You're showing her what it looks like when it's done properly.
Maybe I can give a quick example. You know, we have a two-wheel bicycle, mm-hmm. you know, with the training wheels on it. And so the idea was like trying to, you know, push her to get her to learn how to pedal.
Right,
know?
Right.
She'll stand on it backwards, forwards, you know, right, she's right. getting the idea. Now she, help, Papa, help me, please, help me, you know what I mean? And there was times when I would, you know, make adjustments on the bike. So I would bend down, get down on one knee. And don't you know that little girl got down on one knee? The left knee on the ground, you know, and fixing something on the bicycle. And then I put my hand on my elbow on my right knee. And when she did that, I like, oh my goodness. It's a beautiful visualization of how much they copy.
Yeah. Yes.
So model.
Everything. Yes. Everything. Yes. Okay. So continuing. Reading. Oh, no. Before reading, I signed my children up for wrestling and jiu-jitsu.
Okay.
Right? Yeah. But before they started, I actually started jiu-jitsu and wrestling a month prior to them so that they could see me practicing.
Oh, so you're modeling practicing?
Yeah.
Conditioning?
Everything.
That's good.
Reading is another big one for me. I mean, how do you expect your kids to want to read unless they see you reading?
Yes.
You see what I'm saying? Yeah. So I make sure that my kids see me reading, writing. They see me doing math. I sit down and do their math with them. I just finished doing a 3D map of the Trail of Tears with my daughter. You know what I mean? It was a project.
That's pretty advanced.
Yeah, she's 10. It was a project, but it's something that I need for them to see me doing it.
So you showed her how to do the research that you did.
Uh-huh.
The reading mm-hmm. and the thinking and... You know, taking notes and all yep. that kind of stuff.
Yep.
All right.
And now you have to be the change or set the example that you want. Yes. Because your kids are going to model your behavior. My children they don't see me leave the house and go to work every day because I leave at 5 o'clock in the morning, but they see me come home every day.
Okay.
You see what I'm saying?
Right.
Every single day. And so in my children's mind, That's what it's supposed to be, that you're supposed to get up and you're supposed to go to work every day.
Yeah.
You see what I'm saying?
Yeah, that's a good habit to have.
Now, this is also called, I'm sorry. However you choose to look at this, you must understand that your children will look at you to figure out how to react to situations that they have not yet learned how to handle.
True that.
Right? Yeah. This is also called social learning or observational learning. Modeling can work in both ways. Just like with learned helplessness, anything that can be learned can also be unlearned, right?
Right.
So you can use modeling to teach new behavior or influence the frequency of previously learned behaviors or increase the frequency of similar behaviors, right? If you see something in your children that you suspect might be modeled from you or your partner, here's a good way to approach addressing these learned behaviors in children. 1, identify the behavior. Find if you find something that your child might do that might seem to be a little bit too grown or something to that effect, the first thing you need to do is be calm, right? Yeah. Be calm. Be calm with your children when observing this behavior and ask them where this behavior came from, which leads me to step 2. Which is a moderate confrontation. Emphasis on moderate. And you'll understand this in a second. Two things are going to happen at this moment. Two things must happen at this moment. Your child must know that this behavior, 1, was inappropriate and your response should reflect that. But you must also realize that your child has learned these behaviors from their environment. So when they're initially corrected, it will likely come with a certain amount of confusion for the child. It would add to the confusion if you blow up and are angry about it. Talk.
Right.
Right? So, it's also important to understand that children do not process information the same way we do. They ask why, because their brains are attempting to build bridges between the gaps in their limited amount of knowledge. And if you haven't thoroughly explained why you shouldn't do something and why you do it, but they shouldn't do it, then how are they supposed to know? You see what I'm saying?
Is this in Dr. Joy's book?
No, this is from my own writing.
Well, you're pretty heavy brother there, you know, because I'm you know, my daughter is like, when I walked in, the granddaughter is, you know, saying why. Now she's in the why stage.
Right.
You know, why? Every time you say something, why? You know, my daughter's taking a lot of time to explain why.
You have to.
I certainly have.
You have to consider that the way your mind works, right? If you're a child, you have maybe one or two ideas in there. There's not a lot going on, right? So in order to connect these ideas to each other, you have to build neural pathways. The way you build those neural pathways is by absorbing information. One piece of information will work to connect another piece of information to another piece of information inside your head. The only way that happens is by absorbing information. If your kid's asking you a why question and you're not satisfying them with an answer, you're doing them an injustice. Really are.
That's real. That's real.
Now, you have to find ways to communicate to your children as adult-like as possible. I caught my daughter cursing, right? Now, I explained to her why it's not good for a child to curse, even though I do it as an adult all the time. I got a potty mouth, I'll tell you right now.
But she can't have a potty mouth, huh?
Right, but how do you explain that to a kid? How do you explain to a kid that, well, adults curse, but children couldn't?
That's right.
Well, here's how I approached it. Because I'm not religious, I'm not going to use any kind of religious excuse. Right. I'm not going to say, well, you'd be condemned to hell or any of that stuff. My motto, or at least my method, is to be as direct as possible and tell them things about the reality that we live in. So the way I explain this to my daughter is, I say, look, children don't curse. Adults do. It's a way that adults communicate with each other to add emotion to the way they speak. But those are emotions that adults do not want to see out of children. And if other adults see you cursing, they may not stop you. There's nothing to stop you from cursing. But what it's going to do is it's going to make those other adults look at you and think that your parents have not done a good job raising you. Everything you do is a reflection of me.
Yes.
You see what I'm saying?
I
do. And that's the only way I can tell. That's the only way I can give that message to her.
Well, let me ask you, has that worked?
No. No. I mean, we catch her with the, I don't know how it works. I don't know how it works, because I mean, we catch my kids with stuff around the house, but my kids are constantly arguing with each other, like most kids are. So
yeah.
I don't know how they act outside of the house. But I know when I was her age and I was in second grade, I was cussing all the time.
I didn't expect you to say no, man. I mean, if I were differing on the methodology. I got to respect the fact that it's your methodology.
Right.
You know, it's kind of like if we're reading the same passages and we come up with a different conclusion, we respect each other's,
right.
You know, thought process,
right.
You know, and result from the process, you know. But I didn't expect you to say no, man.
I thought about it for a second. I was going to say, man, should I say yeah? But then I thought about it and I said, well, we did catch her cussing the other day. It's not like she's just dropping F-bombs left and right. It's not one of those things. But, you know, you'll be in the room and then you hear something like, what the shit? And who's talking like that?
Yeah.
You know?
Well, let me ask you this, because it may be a good thing that you brought it up, because I can think of many people who are less enlightened than you.
Mm-hmm.
See? And they just think this is part of their blackness.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I question that myself, you know, but they think it's part of it. So, you know, you think the way you think and you do what you do. And so what suggestions might you offer to other parents that are in that same situation?
Well, the best thing I could do would be to continue what I wrote right here.
Okay.
Because after catching my daughter and explaining to her why, you know, that it would make me and her look bad, I had to identify the source, right?
Okay.
I know for a fact who the source is. The source is myself. I'm a veteran. I'm a construction worker, and I got the potty mouth. I talk crazy, so I cuss like a effing champ, right?
Yes.
Page turn. After you identify the negative source, the next thing is to remove this negative source, right? So it's not just enough for me to tell my daughter that she shouldn't cuss, but I have to edit my own behavior around her so that even if I do catch myself cussing, I also catch myself, or let her see me catching myself, hey, I probably shouldn't be saying this. Or you start a cuss jar or something like that. Something to reinforce the positive behavior to that lets you know that that is a negative behavior.
What's a cuss jar?
A cuss jar? A swear jar? You know, put a quarter or 5 cents in there every time you drop a swear word?
Somehow that sounds familiar. Yeah, that's, I kind of like that idea.
Yeah, every time you drop
or
a swear
penny,
word.
Penny?
Yeah.
Like the kids, you know, give them some pennies and then every time.
Absolutely.
You know, or dollars or nickels or quarters or something.
But that would only work with me because my kids don't get money. So I'll be putting all the money into the swear jar. It'd be ice cream money by the end of the week.
Well, if they don't cuss, then they could use that money for something.
Right. Right. Now, the last thing I want to say on this is, as you begin to remove these negative sources from your life, if you are the negative source, you can identify that and edit your own behavior. But if somebody else is the negative source and they're dealing with your child, you have to remove that negative source. Now, I ran into a situation a couple weeks ago where I was at the bank. Now, I just happened to be eavesdropping on the conversation. And this lady was talking to another lady about a negative source that was around her child all the time. And the negative source just happened to be the baby daddy's mother.
Not the baby's daddy.
No.
The grandmother. Mother.
The grandmother, right? Mm. And so this lady found herself in a bind because she doesn't want to say anything out of line to the grandmother, but at the same time, the grandmother's doing things that she doesn't agree with. And okay. I had to butt in and tell her, like, just my personal opinion is you have to have those conversations. As uncomfortable as they are, you have to have those conversations because first off, closed mouths don't get fed. So if you've allowed somebody to put you in a position to where you're upset all the time at things that they're doing, they may not even know that you're upset. They may be thinking that everything that they're doing is just fine. And because you've never said anything, you've never addressed the behavior, it never gets addressed. You're going to be the one to keep getting upset.
Well, in an effort to, let's call that the big step.
It's a big step.
You know, yeah, big. That's the big step. So
it's a big step.
I'm kind of thinking that maybe if we suggest that if you can't take the big step, right, you take smaller steps.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't know if I should or you should, or one of us go first, the other one go second. What could you suggest be a little step?
Talking to him first.
Good one. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Talking to him first.
You took my thunder, man. Yeah, you're talking to him first. Okay.
Yeah.
So talking to him first, and then maybe as another little step, you know, waiting for an opportunity when everything is, you know, hunky-dory, you know, smooth, peaceful, quiet, you know, everybody's having a good time. Maybe you're alone. Maybe another step would be, so you're alone with grandma. Oh, no. Let me take
that. Yeah, don't do that one.
He's alone.
Yeah.
With grandma. Let him introduce it.
First.
That's what I think would be another little step.
Providing he's not too coward to talk to his own mother.
Yeah, yeah. And then after that, another little step would be the two of you.
Right.
The two parents of this child talk to the grandma at the same time in a non-confrontational way.
Right.
You know, and then maybe another step might be, give it a little bit of time, you know, before you bring it up again.
And if worse comes to worse, you have to, you can always make people miss you.
Yeah, I was thinking that too. I said, then there's another step was also, well, you know, we're busy.
Yeah, you can always make people miss you. You can make them remember why they need you.
Yes.
You see what I'm saying? It's I have no problem with cutting people off for a little bit of time just to make you remember that hey, we used to be cool.
And sounds to me like that is what some people might call diplomacy.
Right.
You know?
Okay. You know?
But that's good. That's good.
So moving on, what you got?
Oh, okay. Okay. So let's move on to the next one. Like I said before, we have quite a few, but the next one has to do with why we must heal. Why we must heal. And, you know, we could say quite a few things there. To get right to it, these internal and external forces have culminated in producing deeply embedded wounds left over from generations of unaddressed and unresolved mental, emotional, and physical abuse. And I really have to applaud Dr. Joy, you know, for that observation, because that was one of the ahas that came to my mind. I think she's right. Trauma is bad enough, but trauma over long periods of time is worse. And worse yet is untreated trauma.
Agreed.
And even worser than that.
Agreed.
You know, is untreated trauma over long periods of time. So we've spent, and Brother Uncommon here, you know, educated me as to the importance of dealing with some of the historical things, i.e., you know, for example, the Black Codes.
Right.
You know. At the beginning of this segment here, we started talking about the labor,
right?
You know, the union labor laws, right, and things like that, you know, and how all of those repercussions have been reverberating through our community. So the idea of having unaddressed and unresolved mental, emotional, and physical abuse, I might add spiritual abuse, you know, is quite significant. So why must we heal? Well, we must heal now. And this is a direct quote from the book on page 158. We must heal now because our failures to do so will impact the generations to come on multiple levels. First, if we continue to allow ourselves to be victimized by the systems and institutions that have afflicted us in the past, we will demonstrate and model, there's that word again,
model
futility. We will model futility and acceptance of despair. So futility and despair. And if we fail to recognize the impact that negative patterns of thinking and behavior, there's that word, behavior, have on us at the genetic level. Now, isn't that interesting? Mm. You know, the genetic level.
The genetic level.
See, so we're talking about mental, emotional, physical, I added spiritual, and now we talk about genetic. You know, I say we will be the authors of our own demise. Now, that's like our own destruction, our own negation, you know, our own death. We must heal now and give the gift of wholeness to our prodigy, which is you know, our children. I could go on to several other things that I you know, kind of scribbled on. I think I'll pick this one. All right. Sometimes there are individuals within our family who are not committed to positive growth, or who may even be dangerous to the family. Do we all know somebody like that?
Mm-hmm.
The family cannot be sacrificed. Let me say that again. The family cannot be sacrificed because of the misguided acts of specific individuals. Neither can it be sacrificed to accommodate any individual member. Some individuals may have to be limited in their ability to engage fully with the family unless and until they make the necessary adjustments to their disruptive attitudes or behavior.
Mm.
This may require outside assistance from others, including professional counselors and therapists. If the disruptive individual manages to change their unacceptable attitudes or behaviors, he or she might be granted re-entry into all or part of the family's regular activities. And I thought that was really powerful. Yeah. You know what I mean? Because it's like saying, look, we ain't standing for your, you know, stuff anymore. You know what I mean?
And your misguided actions ain't going to bring the rest of us down.
Yeah, that cuts the cycle, the crap cycle.
Yes.
You know, she gives an example of somebody named Oscar, and as quickly as I can, because I think that point stands alone. You know, it's it's powerful enough. Because how many times do we accept other people's crazy behavior? You know, Uncle Joe that likes to, you know, do stuff. Oh. You know, you just name what the stuff is. You know, people in church hitting on each other, you know, when they shouldn't be. You know, cousin so-and-so is taking drugs or drinking liquor, you know, or likes to steal from, you know, the family. You know, there's just so many negative behaviors that some members of our family may have, and we want to try to help them, as you just mentioned, by modeling, you know, and so forth. But if it gets to the point where they are demonstrating over and over and over again that they're not going to make that change, then we got to say, well, then our family doesn't do this.
Right.
You know, and if that's the way you're going to do, you have to do it on your own.
Right.
You know what I mean? I'm not throwing any particular person out, you know, to the wolves, you know, but the idea is that you got to come to a point where there's a limit to just how far they can go.
But see, that's the thing. And that's what you just said. You're not going to throw a person out to the wolves. Is that throwing a person out to the wolves?
To some extent, yes.
I mean, I kind of disagree with that, because okay. you're protecting yourself in the name of not dealing with somebody who won't protect themselves.
Yes.
Right. So I am throwing you to the wolves, mm-hmm. because that's where you want to be.
Okay.
Right.
Okay.
Cause I have people in my family like that. I have people in my family like that. And while you don't want to see, people just, you never want to feel like you're throwing anybody away, but at the same time, you want to help people who want to help themselves. Especially if you're a person who helps yourself.
Yes.
Right? Or am I wrong on that?
No, I think you're right. It's just, when do you call it that way? You know, that becomes a personal decision amongst the family members.
And not only that, but your own personal loyalty is at play too.
Yes. It can be very hurtful.
It can be.
You know.
It can be. That's a difficult one to approach.
Yeah, yeah. You know, so it's a tough one, but we must heal.
Right.
You see that's so, like, either you with it or you ain't.
Yeah.
You see, and it becomes a personal choice where you decide how far you're going to go and where that ain't is going to be.
What's your line?
Yeah.
What's your line?
You know, she mentioned later somewhere after that about somebody named Oscar. And if I remember correctly, he invited everybody who was present because they had a family where everybody's cussing. You know, well, I don't, she doesn't say cussing or cursing, but they got lots of bad history.
Okay.
You know, I mean, she doesn't say who did what and all that kind of stuff. But this family was going back and forth on stuff and always raising up old injuries, hurts.
Oh man, why you got to bring up old shit?
Yeah,
right.
Yeah, you know. So they were arguing with each other.
Right,
you know,
right.
And it got to the point where one of the persons said something about inviting everybody to share all of their burdens, their injuries, their sorrows, their pains, their sufferings. You know, and got it to the point where, under one condition, that you know, he walked around the empty space in the middle of the living room where everybody was gathered. They made a complete circle, and they stated that he wanted all to imagine that there was a big, huge hole in the middle of this big circle that right. they were in. So imagine the imagery of that, you know. And he says that they could say whatever they wanted to say without interruption. But once it was said, they dropped it into the hole.
And never came back up.
So now that's a heck of a sinkhole, man.
And what that does is that it allows you to heal.
Exactly.
It allows you to heal. You got it out.
Yes.
And you know everybody heard it. And now everyone else can heal because they know what you said, but they also know that, okay, it's not going to come back up. We're not going to relive in this moment.
Right. See, bury the hurt, the pain, the sorrow, the resentments, the anger, the frustration, the anxiety, you know, all of that stuff, the grudges and all that, you know, the right. old memories, the past and all that kind of stuff, you know, and they were able to come out of that. And according to what Dr. Joy is saying, that particular method did work.
I like that. I think that's something that it's almost like having an intervention.
Yes, it is.
Okay.
Yeah.
You got anything else on that one?
No, I'm going to leave that one because, you know, you got one.
I do. And for my next section of the book that I wanted to cover, my next chapter, one second here. Let me flip through these pages. I wanted to talk about... Oh, my notes are a mess this week. Yeah, here we go. Taking control of our inner world. So I'm actually going to read a section from the book, the section that she wrote on this. The anger that lies just below our awareness and at times bursts forth, seemingly out of our control, is real. There's much to be angry about. Many of us have accepted that these feelings are simply the way we are. But this is not just simply, quote unquote, the way we are. This anger contributes to a shortened lifespan. To some degree, this anger is killing us. It is like a pain that we've adapted and accepted. And unfortunately, as we adapt and accept, we don't see the need to handle our anger and reduce our stress. When human beings are exposed to stress early in their lives, it can have profound effects on their ability to manage and control emotion as they get older. Doctors have actually found a stress hormone, cortisol, that clouds our ability to be rational. For many, the effects of this stress hormone begin before they are even born. Recent studies have revealed that pregnant women can pass cortisol through the placenta to the infant, the impact of which can be devastating. After the birth, the continual exposure to the stress releases more cortisol into the bloodstream, preventing the neural connections necessary to access higher brain functioning. And this release of higher levels of cortisol could result in limited learning ability. Under stress, with our higher brain functions inhibited by cortisol, our lower brain functions like fight or flight take over. Responses become prominent. When these lower functions are in play, children and adults begin to live as though every stressful event is a threat, and, which in turn causes the release of more cortisol, further inhibiting the access to the reasoning parts of the brain. You can probably recall instances where you have witnessed individuals faced with a simple direction who respond as though they are under attack. Once stressed, the individual must return to a calm and balanced state in order to access the ability to reason. Some people live in a constant state of crisis, becoming in a way addicted to stress and finding ways to trigger the release of cortisol, living in a perpetual state of conflict. The good news is that we can take measures to mitigate our anger, reduce our stress, and feel more at ease and at peace. We can take measures to gain greater control of ourselves and the way we respond to our world. This, too, is part of healing. Given that much of the anger we feel is a direct result of being wronged, we need to find effective ways to address the mistreatment that will make things right. And our response to unjust treatment naturally arouses feelings of frustration. And that at times, we often let our anger get the best of us instead of determining how to right the wrong. we respond angrily, which helps, which neither helps us attain what is rightfully ours, nor alleviates that feeling stirred up by the event. For example, imagine being shorted on your paycheck. There is no benefit in becoming angry or yelling at the clerk who delivered your check to you and storming out of the building. After all, the clerk had nothing to do with the mistake, and leaving the building in a rage won't get you the money that you're owed. If you were to find yourself in this situation, what are some of the workable options available to you? Whatever the case, regardless of whatever is occurring, is blatant racism, a personality conflict, or just a simple accounting error, you must retain a level of composure that allows you to make rational decisions. It is impossible to make sound decisions while simultaneously being enraged. For many, this sounds like common sense, but for those who have a few tools other than anger or aggression to confront injustices imposed upon them, this is no easy task. So first, if you're angry, wait for your anger to subside, which may require for you to remove yourself from the situation for a while. Remember, it is almost impossible to think rationally when you're angry, so find a way to wait until you're calm. Once you've calmed down, you can plan your response. More often than not, you will find you have many options. Probably the most obvious option would be to determine the source of the error and begin the process of correcting the matter. If the problem occurred because of a simple accounting error, you might have an easy time of fixing the trouble. But if your manager has deliberately docked your hours, ask for a written explanation, then produce in writing evidence that supports your argument. If you still cannot solve the problem, follow the proper grievance procedures and consider finding a better employment. So I'll leave it right there. That's about halfway through. Now, yeah, consider finding a better employer, right? Okay, so when I was reading this, I thought about something. Have you ever seen a cartoon called The Boondocks, Mr. D?
I remember it was a cartoon.
Uh-huh, but they came from the newspaper, you're right.
From a newspaper, yeah.
You're right.
So I remember, passing by it. It was what interested me in it. I didn't really stop to look into it too deeply, but what interested me in it was our community. Our community was being depicted in the cartoon.
Oh, you don't need, if you haven't seen it, you don't know how true that is.
Yeah.
So what the cartoon is about, it's about these two young boys and their grandfather. I'm not sure what the circumstances are, but they end up coming into a bunch of money. The grandfather's taking care of the boys, and he decides to move them out of the hood and into suburbia.
Oh,
right. Okay. So the cartoon kind of explains their experiences in the process, and they have, and it's not a children's cartoon. It is very, very, very adult. And just as a side note, one of the most interesting characters in the cartoon is a character named Uncle Ruckus, who is a black man who
Ruckus
thinks he's white.
Don't raise a ruckus, huh?
Yeah, he thinks he's white, straight up.
Oh, my God.
Oh, yeah, in the first episode, he sings, when he meets the two boys and the grandfather, he's at this big party with, you know, a ritzy-type high-class party, and he's working there, and he takes the mic and starts singing, "Don't trust them niggas over yonder."
What?
Yeah. It's crazy.
Controversy.
It's crazy. No, but see, the reason that I love the cartoon so much is because it does talk about black issues, yes, within the black community from the black perspective.
Yes.
The man who writes it, Aaron Magruder, is a black man. And
right,
one of the episodes that he wrote was one called the Rise of Stink Meaner. I'm not sure if that's the name of the episode, but I know it's definitely the Stink Meaner episode for anyone who knows about it. And in that episode, in the very, very beginning of the episode, they set up the entire episode by explaining what a nigga moment is.
Okay.
You familiar with that term?
No.
Okay.
But I think I, but tell me.
Okay. So they set it up by having these two guys walking across the street and one of them bumps the other one. And then it turns into the classic testosterone, what you looking at type of fest. That's a nigga moment. So I looked it up in the Urban Dictionary, and a nigga moment is in the Urban Dictionary described as a moment in which ignorance overruns the brain, causing an outburst of irrational aggression.
Oh, so everybody can be a nigga.
Right. Yeah. Everybody? Yeah, everybody. As it turns out. Yes.
Read that definition again.
A nigga moment is a moment in which ignorance overruns the brain, causing an outburst of irrational aggression.
Ignorance.
Right. And
overcomes the brain.
To be honest with you, I tend to see nigga moments of people who are not considered classical niggas, but that's we'll talk about that another story. So in this episode, new shoes were the culprit for this altercation. Granddad's walking outside singing the new shoes song, new shoes, I got new shoes. And Stinkmeaner, who is a blind man, steps on his shoes. And a nigga moment ensues, and they end up having a fight.
Right.
So,
because he messed up his shoes, or he stepped on his toe.
You know it's the shoes. It's the brand new shoes. You scuffed my Pumas. You know. So in reality, new shoes could very well get a man killed. Right. Yes. I mean, we've seen that happen so many times. But what is
unfortunately that's true.
What is it that causes these moments of irrationality?
Nigga moments.
What causes that? It's a lack of control.
Okay.
It's a lack of control of your inner life.
Watch where you walking, nigga.
Hey, what you say, nigga?
Watch closely. You're about to experience a nigga moment. Webster defines the nigga moment as a moment when ignorance overwhelms the mind of an otherwise logical Negro male.
What did you say, bitch nigga? Hey, squeeze it, nigga!
Causing him to act in an illogical, self-destructive manner, i.e., like a nigga. Nigga moments are unpredictable.
Hey, wait, man, wait! This is stupid.
Hey, you right, dawg. Look, let's put the guns away and go on about our business.
Freeze!
But they all end up bad. If they had their own category, nigga moments would be the third leading killer of black men behind pork chops and FEMA. It's a fact.
You see what I'm saying?
I do.
Now, my wife goes through these moments from time to time. My wife can be a hothead. As much as...
Now, she's going to listen. She's going to listen to this, right?
Oh, yeah. She's going to listen to it.
Okay. You're going to have to take her out to dinner or something.
Oh, no. My wife knows she's a hothead.
Oh, she does?
Oh, my wife knows she's a hothead. See, here's the thing, though. My wife is 5'2" and like 155 pounds. But my... Or 5'... No, she's 5'3½" or something like that. She's gonna say 5'4" when we argue about this, when we're listening to it in bed.
Yes, but that's coming.
Yeah, but right now she's about 155 pounds.
Okay,
right, but she used to be significantly larger, and what she's finding is that now that she lost all this weight, her nigga moments have increased.
Oh.
Because people come at her now because she's smaller. You're not going to come at a big burly person, but you'll tell a small person to go fuck off.
Okay.
Right? And so she's experiencing this more often. And what actually had to make her really suppress her own attitude and really tamper down is jujitsu.
Oh.
It's when she started doing jujitsu and she realized that as tough as you might think you are, there's a dude that is wearing glasses that weighs about 130 pounds who's gonna turn into a spider monkey on your back, and he's gonna tighten you up, and he's gonna fold your clothes up while you're wearing them is the term that I like to use.
Sounds like if you think you're so bad, you'll find somebody better.
Right, yeah. Right, and see, for her, jujitsu put two things in her head. The one was that you are a dangerous person. And so since you're a dangerous person, you don't need to respond to every idiot on the street who you know you can hurt. Right. Okay. But the other thing it put in her head is that other people on the street are a lot more dangerous as you. So you should watch what you say to people.
I follow exactly what you're saying.
Right.
That's the classic martial arts mentality.
Yeah.
You know, since you know you can defend yourself.
You don't need to walk around doing it.
You don't need to.
Yeah, you don't have to.
You walk away from a situation.
And that came with empowerment. That is empowerment. And it came with self-improvement.
Good.
Right? Yeah. So a lot of that gives you the ability to have some control over your own life, your own emotions, and your own self. Right. I know everyone's not going to be able to draw on jujitsu for that kind of experience, but it's just, some personal things from our life were for how we were able to get over it. Because I was in the same boat for a long time.
Please say that again for emphasis.
Oh, that is a personal thing?
Well, that whole process, you know, where you don't really have to act.
Oh,
you know, when it comes to, because you are a jujitsu, in her particular case, you know, because you have those skills, you know you can defend yourself.
Oh, yeah. You don't feel that you have to walk around and okay, here's what it does. It takes the chip off of your shoulder.
Thank you.
It takes the chip off of your shoulder because you understand that you yourself are a dangerous person. It gives you the confidence and the skills to be that dangerous person. So you don't
need be.
If need be.
Right.
And so since you know that you're that person, you don't have to walk around and prove that you're that person. When you see people on the street who are walking around poking their chest out, trying to get the attention of everybody and show them how tough they are, they have something to prove.
Yes.
You don't.
Yes. See that? So it could come from some other accomplishment, some other success, some other victory that you've had. Something happened for you that you wanted to happen for a long time, and it's finally happened.
I can tell you where it happens for most.
And stuff, huh?
I can tell you where it happens for most people.
Okay.
When they have kids.
Yeah, that's. I think you're right.
For a lot of people, that's what really makes them grow up and get out of all the drama that they were in when they were kids, is they have kids of their own.
Well, then I should say, I'm thankful for purpose.
Right.
Purpose. You know, it's allowed me to overlook a lot of things.
Right.
It's allowed me to focus my life now. I don't really want to talk about me, but I'm using me as an example because that's the example that I live with. That's the one I know the most about. But yeah, I think you're absolutely right. Whatever your talent or skill is, you know, the talent is something that you kind of do, mm-hmm. you know, you do it naturally. There's a book called What Color Is Your Parachute?
Mm.
You know, by... what's his name? Richard Nelson, I believe it is. 10 Speed Press. He talks about the difference between talents and skills.
Right.
You know, the skills are the things that you learn. For example, learning how to drive a car.
Mm-hmm.
Typing. Computer. You know, stuff like that. Reading.
Right.
The talent is the thing that you kind of do, and one way to recognize the talent is that when you do it, you feel good. You know, when you do it, it becomes like time goes by fast, you know?
It's natural.
Yeah, there you go.
It's natural.
I try not to say the word natural, but
second
that's
nature.
Usually what happens.
Second nature?
Yeah.
It becomes second nature?
Yeah. And that's one way to recognize it, you know? That's what I mean when I say you do it. You know, it's just something that you do. And so whatever that success is from that talent and or that skill, the training, the self-confidence, you know, whatever that example is, it doesn't have to be jiu-jitsu.
It doesn't have to be.
You know,
that's my personal thing.
Yeah, but it's whatever your personal thing is. Thank you for that. You know, and from that you can build on that, you know, and you can get the confidence that you need to be able to pick and choose your options about dealing with the injuries and the misgivings and you know, the hurt and the pain and the suffering that you think somebody else did.
And you're adding value to yourself and your own self-worth, which gives you more self-confidence, which in turn gives you more control of your inner world.
And thus you experience the healing.
Now, that's all I have on my number two. What you got?
Well, that was number two?
That was number two for me.
Okay. Well, this has been kind of interesting. You know, you've said a couple of things that I kind of, you know, thought were important too. Let me start by mentioning, you know, you mentioned learned helplessness, right?
Mm-hmm.
Do you remember talking about efficacy?
I've covered it briefly when we talked about learned helplessness.
Yeah. Can you give our audience, a real quick and dirty kind of definition on what efficacy is? First, I'm going to talk about the learned helplessness. You know, and the idea of learned helplessness is that, like, some external situation that, you know, you begin to accept. It may even be detrimental to you, but the idea is that, you know, you're beginning to accept that you can't do anything about it.
Right.
See?
Okay.
Now, efficacy, what is that?
Efficacy is a person's belief that they have the ability to carry out a specific task.
Yes. Excellent. So, in the book here, on page 163, they talk about learned helplessness or... Mm-hmm. Learned self-efficacy.
I started to cover that one too. I'm glad you did it.
Yeah, on page 163.
Got it.
It says, there is a lot we need to know about how and why things work in America. If we plan to remain here, you know. We plan to remain here.
Well, for most of us, we don't have a choice, so listen up.
Yeah, we got to deal with it, you know. Like, so anyway, we need to better understand how the system at work benefits or harms us. So there's a whole idea of benefit or harm. We now have several generations of African-Americans that have never looked outside of their daily struggle for survival to notice how their lives are consistently impacted and controlled by others. Many are unaware of how the policy decisions of local and state government directly affect their daily lives. Some are young and apathetic. They blindly follow without question the directions and signs that are placed before them. Signs that tell us where they can live, work, eat, and play. They follow because they fear or doubt the possibilities that they can do anything different to change the particular situation in which they find themselves. This behavior is sometimes referred to as learned helplessness. Now, I think that's important. Now, it goes on to say some other things, but for the sake of time, I want to kind of drop to the healing part, the solution, you know, the empowerment part of it. In other words, you know, it's called like knowing ourselves. You know, I'm just going to read the first sentence of each one of these paragraphs because it says, so who and what we are? If we are to believe what the dominant society would seemingly let us believe, the lies they propagate, we are stupid, we are criminal, we are unmotivated, we are lazy, we are underachieving, we are immoral, we are undisciplined. Whew. In a word, inferior. History reveals a very, very different story. And here comes the healing. African-American people are strong. African-American people are industrious.
Very.
African American people are creative people. African American people are just and forgiving people. African American people are spiritual, loving, and hopeful people. These are some of the components of our true nature. We as a people seem to have forgotten this. This is who we are. This is who we were. And this is who we will continue to be. We seem to have forgotten our own nobility, and the word nobility is one of the reasons why I haven't suffered through some of that crap that some people have suffered through. Now, I've gone through my own trials and tribulations, but it's because the people that I grew up with, you know, my parents and others, were always talking about, remember, you come from kings. We are kings and queens. You know, we are authors. We are mathematicians. We are scientists. You know, we are mothers. We are fathers. You know, they were always stressing that.
Inventors.
Oh, man. See, now that's a good one right there. We could talk about that for
yes. Forever. Yes, we can.
Yes. And so the whole idea of nobility, which capsulizes the goodness in us, you know, in spite of all of this other stuff that has happened, you know, we still remain that way. And you know, and I know, and everybody who hears this knows, they see it every single day.
Yes.
You know, the idea of building self-esteem, which is recognizing that, you know, we have intrinsic value in and of ourselves, I think is key to this. You know, the idea of we begin to develop our own narrative within ourselves, and it begins to spread outside the family. Well, no, let me take that back. This is spread within the family.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And from that, it spreads outside the family is one of the healing solutions that I think will eliminate all of this traumatic syndrome.
Yes. Agreed. 100%. Oh, man. This is the first time that we recorded the show that I didn't feel like I had to take a shower afterwards for talking about a bunch of disgusting material.
And I have to admit, that wasn't my thing to begin with, but I thank you, and I thank Dr. Joy, and there are many others, you know, who have brought to light the unpleasantness, because recognition of that, you know, was able to kind of figure out like where it kind of came from.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like I said before, I grew up with many people who weren't focusing on that.
Right.
You know what I mean? I mean, I knew about it, you know, you have to know about it, you know, but the idea was they say, well, don't focus on that.
Right.
You see? And so the healing part of this was the thing that interested me way more than all the other history. But again, I got to thank you, you know.
No, I thank you.
For bringing that stuff up, because that's like the real stuff.
Right.
You know what
I mean? It is.
And a lot of people are still caught up in that.
And that's the thing, you know, the reason this book is so important is because there's so much truth in it. And there's so much truth in it that really, really reflects on all of us. And if you have not been introduced to this type of material, you will think that, like I read in the section that I just read, you'll think that it's just the way things are. Or it's just the way that Black people are, or it's just the way that society is, and that's wrong.
Yeah, you're right. They gotta question that.
That's wrong. You have to start to begin to think critically. And in fact, did you have anything else on this?
Well, like I said, we only tried to pick out three, but you know, I'm looking at about 10 different markers, you know what I mean? So since you open up that door, allow me just to read one more.
Absolutely.
Yeah,
absolutely.
I didn't need to, but you know, since you asked,
no, go for it.
You know, I thank Dr. Joy for this quote. This is on page 169. It says, in an African American culture, there is no lack of pride in the accomplishments of our family members and friends. However, there is a frequency plausibility of personal one-on-one accomplishments on deeds. I have often heard parents praise other members of their family once they have left the room. Once they have left the room? As if to praise them in their presence would be improper. In the absence of voiced recognition and praise from elders, children often feel like their parents are not proud of them and carry a lifetime of self-doubt as to their worth. Mm. Healthy esteem comes from healthy and positive exchanges with the people in our lives on whom we depend for support and guidance.
And what we learned about learned helplessness a few weeks ago is that it often starts in childhood.
There you go. I think she's right. I think you're right. And therein, you know, rests the case. The case is that we can do the healing just by changing our mind. As a matter of fact, I don't need to read the book anymore as far as this is concerned, because I want to go to a personal experience, which was very, very humbling. You know, I was working in an organization. I was around like I was the only black person on the sales team, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And we're going all over the place, selling the particular product. It was legal services. Uh-huh. You know, we had to deal with, big law firms. So, I'm wearing suit and tie and all this stuff, I'm going all over the city,
right.
Sometimes it got to be kind of taxing because I was doing that, in the summertime. Suit and tie. Everybody else is wearing a suit and tie. So I got to look like everybody else look.
Right.
Everything's matching. I'm looking real dap,
Right, right.
See? And sometimes I'd come back, a little hungry, a little tired, or just plain exhausted, man, because it was too hot.
Crazy.
So one time I walked into the lobby of the building, and I saw on a piece of paper in between the two elevator doors. Now, they were about four on one side, four on the other side. And this is what it said. It said, if you want to change your life, change your mind.
That's powerful.
Let me read it again. And for those that hear this, please spread it on to as many people as you can. And if each one spreads it to 10, and those 10 spread it to 10 each, that's 100, that's a mathematical exponent.
Yes.
If you want to change your life, change your mind. Period.
So simple.
Yes. See, that's where the healing is.
Yeah.
See?
I love that. I love that as a quote. I'm going to use that. If you want to change your life, change your mind. You got a song playing inside my head. I'm thinking about Michael Jackson's Man in the Mirror.
Yes. Michael was brilliant about that one.
Oh, man.
I took the paper. I told the guy, I said, hey, man, listen, you mind if I take this upstairs and make a copy of it? He said, no, you can't. I said, look, man, this spoke to me. I will bring it back for real. He says, okay, I'll trust you. I went up and made a copy of it. I don't know where that copy is now, but I did make a copy of it and I gave it to, different people that I knew. But it's in my mind.
Exactly. It's right here.
Yeah. And now it's in the air.
Right. It's in the zeitgeist. Oh. All right. Well, I got one more.
Okay.
I got one more. Because the last section that I decided to dig into from the healing chapter is evidence-based approaches.
Oh.
Right.
Okay.
Because we live in 2020, and there are so many people who have been conditioned to believe in fairy tales, right?
Yes.
And a lot of this is because of the way that we've conditioned ourselves to learn. Just taking someone's word for something as opposed to going out there and finding out if there's any truth in it, or if you've or if you can verify the information, if you can vet it. There's too many ways to find confirmation bias, right? So what I did is I decided to have a little bit of fun with this one. Okay?
Okay.
So I found the criteria for looking at something with an evidence-based approach, right?
Okay.
I found four criteria.
Right.
But instead of doing this big write-up on this, I decided to take these four criteria and find four examples of this going bad.
Okay.
Right? Okay. So, criteria number one for an evidence-based approach to something is it has to be studied using the appropriate scientific methodology, right?
Okay.
So that means that if you are interested in a deadly pandemic, for example, don't take your advice from a chiropractor.
Okay.
Right?
Yes. Yes.
Criteria number two, it's replicated with consistent results in more than one geographic or practice setting.
Okay.
Okay. So that means that more than one person in more than one place has replicated the same results. Okay.
Okay.
So criteria number three is it's recognized in scientific peer-reviewed journals by one or more published articles.
Yes.
Okay. So what that means is that someone came to a scientific finding. Then they gave their evidence to other people who study the same or similar material. And then those people vetted that person's findings to see if they could come to the same conclusions or if that person's full of it, right?
Okay.
And then the last criteria is it's followed up with implementation guides.
Okay.
Okay. So let's go back to criteria number one. Studied using appropriate scientific methodology. Okay. I found a very good example of this not being done. Have you ever heard of Samuel Hahnemann?
No, I haven't.
Samuel Hahnemann was born on April 10th, 1755, and died on July 2nd, 1843. Now, Dr. Samuel Hahnemann was not a terrible person, as some of the people who I talk about are. But he was a doctor who had become disenchanted with medicine because of how barbaric it was. Now, medicine in the 1780s was not medicine today. It wasn't even close. It was actually barbaric. And he was probably justified in leaving his practice, which he did in 1784. So let's see. In 1784, he left his practice and began working as a writer. He wrote a column dedicated to solving medical mysteries. This is when a reader sent him a sample of a Peruvian tree called the cinchona. The reader claimed that this tree was a cure for malaria. Dr. Hahnemann investigated and seen that the sample actually gave him symptoms of malaria, right? Mm-hmm. So this discovery led him to found an entire branch of pseudoscience known as homeopathy.
Okay.
You ever heard of it?
Yes.
You familiar with it?
A little.
Okay. He believed that he could cure illnesses in people by giving them substances that produced similar effects to the symptoms that they were currently suffering from, right? So the they called it like cures like. Okay. So the idea was, if you are vomiting and have diarrhea, I'm going to make a concoction of some kind of poison that causes vomiting and diarrhea. Right?
Okay.
Because I'm treating you by giving you the same thing that you're suffering from. So that was the basis in homeopathy. Now, this led them to begin taking poisons such as deadly nightshade and diluting them down till there was almost nothing left of the poison in the mix, and then using that mixture as a medicine. Mixing often goes bad in homeopathy, and a lot of children have died from homeopathic products, numbering in the thousands. Highlands, spelled H-Y-L-A-N-D-S, is a big homeopathic company that still exists today and sells poison/medicine to children. You familiar with Highlands?
No, I'm not.
I've given my stepkids from Highland until I found out about them.
Really?
Yeah, it's pretty crazy. And then when you look at it, when you look at the label and see what's in it, and you start to research some of that stuff, it'll have you just gasping.
Make you think not to do it?
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay, so number two. Criteria number two is replicated with consistent results in more than one geographic practice or setting. The best example I could think of for this was the Chinese famine that lasted between 1958 and 1962. You familiar with that?
No.
Oh, okay. For a brief history, China had just come out of about 30 years of civil wars, and the communist government had just won. Mao Zedong attempted to bring the country out of poverty by instituting the Great Leap Forward program. With a little advice from a Russian scientist named Trofkin Lysenko, Mao Zedong made sweeping changes to China's farming system that resulted in a famine that literally starved 45 million people. Entire regions worth of people were reduced to stripping the community pets for food. Many even resorted to eating the dead, because of the stubbornness and poor political decisions. So you hadn't heard anything about that before, the Chinese famine?
I have, yes.
Oh, okay. So that is a great example for what happens if you try and do something that's not replicated with consistent results in more than one geographic practice or setting. What happened in that case was they were trying to do something that was basically a huge experiment.
Yes.
It was really a huge experiment, and a lot of people paid for it. And really, once they started to fix the changes that caused the famine, everything went back to normal within a matter of a couple months. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it was pretty sad story. So
so why should we use it then?
Why should we use what?
That method.
No, we shouldn't.
Oh.
No. I was using an example because the criteria was that it has to be replicated with consistent results in more than one geographic practice or setting. Story I just told, they didn't do that. They tried some experimental stuff, and about 45 million peasants died.
See, in other words, that is the non evidence based process.
Exactly. So criteria number three has to be recognized in scientific peer-reviewed journals by one or more published articles. Now, this is an interesting one, right? Because it's important not to be conditioned to just accept what you hear, especially in 2020, because there's so much misinformation out there, disinformation and misinformation. And they're two different things, and they're both out to get you. Just keep that in mind. So since we live in a world where there's so many ways to have your biases confirmed, how do you know if some bit of science is legit? Well, that's what peer reviews are for, right? Let's take a look at the vaccines linked to autism, for example. The source of this non-existent link is actually still alive. His name is Andrew Wakefield, and you can find him very easily. He's a con artist that is currently claiming that COVID-19 is a hoax. His work, however, is infamous. He claimed that the MMR vaccine caused quote-unquote leaky intestines and autism in children who received it. The Lancet was duped by Wakefield and ran on February 28th, 1998. They published an article called "The Ileolymphoid Nodular Hyperplastia Nonspecific Colitis and Pervasive Developmental Disorder in Children."
That's a mouthful, right?
Yeah, I'll do it again.
That's dubious, man.
Ileolymphoid, Jesus. Ileolymphoid nodular hypoplastia, nonspecific colitis, and pervasive developmental disorder in children.
Okay.
Right?
Okay.
So, who is the Lancet? The Lancet is one of the oldest medical journals. They write weekly peer reviews on all things medicine, and because of that, they are well respected in the medical community. Now, after posting this article, it took a federal investigator to entangle this mess. Andrew Wakefield's claims were eventually debunked, and The Lancet had to retract the article, but by then the damage had been done. For as long as there have been vaccines, there have been anti-vaxxers, but it's these shady-ass doctors who are willing to put their names on pseudoscience who are actually the real pieces of shit. Andrew Wakefield lied his off to people who were too lazy to do a thorough peer review. What they did is they basically just took his word for it and signed off on it. And then as a result, we can fast forward a couple years and we see Jenny McCarthy using that same pseudoscience to tell suburban moms of the dangers of vaccinations on Oprah. And she was using Andrew Wakefield's bad science. Now, Andrew Wakefield is no longer allowed to practice medicine. He's been reduced to the circuit of right-wing propaganda media shows such as Alex Jones InfoWars and Glenn Beck's The Blaze. I know, that was a lot. That was a lot. But I think it's important because what happened is that was the actual, in that example, peer review went wrong.
Yes.
Because his peers didn't actually do the review the way they were supposed to. They just kind of said, oh, it's fine.
So let me ask you a question. It's meant to separate, the truth from the falsity. You know, how are we able to deal with that situation of peer reviewing, being used ineffectively? In other words, it eventually was disproven.
True.
Yeah.
It was. But see, I really don't think that there's much that you can do in this case, because like you said, it was disproven. It just took a while. And what actually happened here is something that happens all the time, where these media companies will run a story and then it'll be disproven or it'll be changed. New information will come to light. And so they'll run a retraction, but nobody sees the retraction.
Okay.
Because the original article is already out there, right?
Let me ask you this question. This is just an open question. You know, so I'm not biased one way or the other.
Okay.
Well, I guess I am, actually, now that I think about it. But let me just ask you the question. I'm curious as to what your answer is. How many times do you think that happens?
Oh, what? Yes. Bad peer reviews?
Yes. Yes.
I don't know, man. I don't want to.
That was too hard a question. Yeah.
No, because I'm thinking about it, and I'm thinking. Well, I mean,
Think about it. What do you think?
I mean,
your opinion, man. That's the way.
I don't know, man. I don't think it happens as often as some of the wingnuts want to say it does. But I do believe it's a thing, and the reason that I do believe that is because. I mean, everybody said that Galileo was wrong until he was proven right. You see what I'm saying?
Oh, you went deep on that one, bro. Yeah, that's true. That is true. You know, and things, Da Vinci and all them.
Things change.
You know, that happens very frequently, in science, engineering, a lot of other places. Yeah, the guy sounds like he's a quack until... it gets confirmed. And I think therein may lie one of the things that we could suggest or recommend to the people that are paying attention to us.
Yeah.
Multiple sources. Right. I think that's very important. Be it politics or science or health or, financial advice, psychological, advice.
Right.
You know, in order to get healthy, what we do is we look for the consistency of it. You know, I think it has to happen more often than it does not.
Yes.
You see, so it's a simple thing, at least to me it is. You know, I might be wrong about it, but I think it's worked a lot. It's like, count up how many times it went this way compared to how many times it went that way. In other words, quantify it.
And that's it. But then what you're doing is you're laying out the evidence to have an evidence-based approach.
Yeah. I'm going to leave it at that because I think that's one of the keys. As a matter of fact, in Joyce's book, they say, let's see. Simply put, strategies for implementing evidence-based quality improvement need an evidence base of their own.
Yeah.
You see? I think they used to call that best practices.
See,
right?
No. What we're actually looking at right now is you have the evidence-based approach versus the best practices. The evidence-based is the antithesis to best practices.
Well, we're using the word best.
Right. But you know. But the way best practices is, if you look up best practices and you look for the definition of it, it's defined as things that exist that have lasted the test of time.
Because they worked.
Because they, yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
See, look, we got to learn from the successes as well as the failures.
True.
You know, so the idea of the thing being something that's moving us towards what it is that we're trying to do, in that sense, I'm using the word best. Allow me just switch over real quick to an analogy that I thought was very powerful. In fact, let me experiment with you.
Okay.
When we say we want to maximize, what does that mean?
Get the most out of.
Out of what?
Whatever it is. I'm not sure when we're trying to maximize what.
Okay. Good point. Now, when we say we want to optimize, what does that mean to you?
To make something as efficient as possible.
Ooh. I kind of feel the same way. You know, a maximization is usually, for one thing, you know, like maximizing profit.
It's like quantity versus quality.
Okay. And the quality would be many things.
Right, because maximizing something is getting the most quantity out of it.
Out of that one thing.
But optimizing something is getting the most quality
out of all of those things.
Yeah.
You see what I mean? And I dare say that one of the reasons why capitalism is a big problem, how many things that human people do is a big problem because of selfishness and greed, is that they want to maximize something for themselves,
right.
Maximize something for their corporation, maximize something for their shareholders, maximize something for their particular stockholders,
right?
You know, stakeholders. I think is the word I want to use. Well, both. Now that I think about it, but then when you optimize things, you see, it's got to be more than just those few groups, those few publics, you know, those few stakeholders. You know, nature optimizes,
mm-hmm.
You see. So it's not only good for, like the fire that comes through, you know.
Right.
We got a lot of fire. You know, it's not, you know, it may destroy, you know, the land, but what else does it do?
It creates new opportunity.
New opportunities for
new know, life.
Yeah, you know, the animals, the shrubs, the grass, you right. know, the earth itself, the trees, the bushes, you know. And all of a sudden, we end up, you know, having a better environment.
You know, you made me think about something. I was talking to somebody and they were talking about how we're coming up on the end of the world. And I said, no, we're not coming up on the end of the world. We're coming up on the end of humanity. There's a difference. The world will still be here.
Oh, yeah. You know, if man could have destroyed the world, I think he would have already. You know, I think you're absolutely right. Now, that's a heavy point to make, you know. So, yeah, the earth itself is almost as if it's alive. I know that may sound kind of
weird. I believe that. I felt that for a long time, that the earth is living.
Yeah. It's not, you know, rocks are alive.
Right.
You know, they're changing, they're interacting with stuff. I mean, if it wasn't for the rocks and the soil and the earth, we wouldn't have water to drink, for goodness sake.
It creates life.
Yeah.
It creates life. So why would it be such a far stretch that it is life?
So we have many, many, many different cycles working in conjunction with each other in order to produce the whole. And in that sense, that's the healing process. You know, that's the solution. And be it in nature or be it, you know, in our own community with many of our people, you know, I think we're trying to suggest a way that, you know, you find the way to optimize your specific situation, you know, be it the choices that you make, be it the recognitions that you give out, being the pride, you know, being the evidence, mm-hmm. you know, just like face the facts, fool.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Right.
And I think you'll find your way moving towards that direction. It may not be perfect, but it sure makes it better.
Now, there's one more criteria. There was four criteria that I started with that I was kind of giving examples of them, of what it looks like if you don't use that portion of the evidence-based approach. Now, the last part was the implementation guide, right?
Okay.
It has to be supported by or followed up with implementation guides, right? So the best definition that I could find of what an implementation guide is was on the website smartsheet.com, who describes it using the term implementation strategy and defines it as the process of defining how to bring a strategic plan to life. To execute the objectives outlined in the strategic plan, you must define how you will implement each aspect, from funding and personnel to organizations and deliverables. Now, obviously, their definition got kind of specific, talking about deliverables and organizations and whatnot. But the earlier part of the definition definitely fit what we're talking about today. And that is the process of defining how to bring a strategic plan to life, right? So the best bad example I could find of how to bring a strategic plan to life was the Trump administration in 2016 through 2020.
Boom. Trump.
that's really it. I mean, I didn't really. I stopped right there. I said, you know what? I'm going to stop right there and say enough said. And if you got a problem with that, you can comment. You can get at me on my emails or on TikTok or Instagram or whatever. And this will be our segue to the end of the show. All right. So, Mr. D, you got anything to leave the people with?
Well, since you ask, I think that's a good place to end. You notice I didn't make a comment about that. You know, you read into that what you want, you know, but I think it's appropriate just to leave it right there. You know, oh, by the way, my daughters, both of them now working on trying to get me a Facebook, you know, Twitter, you know, et cetera, so I can be, you know, updated.
Awesome,
you know
what I mean? Awesome.
Yeah. They're both working on it now. Daddy, you need to, you know. Anyway, I think it might be useful, and I have to give Dr. Joy, you know, credit for this, you know, the 6 core principles of improvement, you know, it's on page 193. She gives a little explanation of each one of these, and I think the explanation is even better than the principle.
Oh, okay.
So, you know, it's kind of interesting because it says, it starts with a simple question. What specifically is the problem? what specifically is the problem that we are trying to solve? You know, this enlivens a co-development orientation. Engage key participants early and often. Sounds simple, but, you know, I think sounds very heavy.
Right.
You know, the critical issue is not what works, but rather what works for whom and under what set of conditions?
Right.
You know, aim to advance efficacy. Uh-oh, that's that word.
Uh-huh.
Reliability at scale, meaning, you know, it works a lot. It gets bigger. You know, she goes on to say, it is hard to improve what you do not yet fully understand. So go see how local conditions shape the work process. Make your hypothesis for change public and clear. Why do we do that? Well, because we want to embed measures of key outcomes and process and track if the change is an improvement. You know, we intervene in complex organizations. We anticipate unintended consequences and measure these too. My own interjection is that, you know, we learn from our successes as well as our failures.
Right.
You know, and then she goes on to say, engage rapid cycles of plan, do, study, act. Plan, do, study, act. To learn fast, fail fast, and improve quickly.
I like that.
Yeah. I kind of think I like it. Learn fast, fail fast, improve fast. You know, that failure may occur is not a problem, but we fail to learn from... Oh, I think I read that wrong. Scratch that out. That failures may occur is not the problem. That we fail to learn from them is... Yes, that's truth right there. And then finally, she says, embrace the wisdom of the crowds. We can accomplish more together than the best of us can accomplish alone. You know, and I'll end with that because I think that, you know, she has given us some solutions, some healing, some things to think about. You know, if you feel that this is not sufficient, then... What do you say? Not you. You know, I'm saying it to the people that are listening. You know, read the book.
Yes.
You know, get the book, you know, and I'm sure you're going to say where you can get the book from.
Oh, absolutely. Right? Absolutely.
You know, and examine it like we did. You know, it took us, 2 months? I mean.
Yeah, we got 6 episodes out of it. You know,
because it just got so heavy.
Yeah.
You know, it's a work in progress, you know. Nobody has all the answers, but I think we all can help to get the answer.
Absolutely. Absolutely. I agree 100%. So, I'm going to do something that I've been forgetting to do on pretty much every recording that I do, and that is something that I'm actually pretty embarrassed about. And so I'm going to get to it right here, and I'm going to say thank you.
Then I better say thank you, too.
I'm going to say thank you to every single listener that we have, because you're the most important part of this show. We couldn't do this without you, and we wouldn't be here without you.
That's right.
So please, please get us out there. Share us with your friends. Subscribe to the channel. Share us on your Facebook. Share us on your Instagram. Let us know that we're out here because we are not going anywhere. And if you want to, a few people have hit me up for books. If you're looking to buy any of the titles that we talk about or any other black book that you can think of, you can find that at shadesofafrica.com. Use the offer code Uncommon Sense so that they know we sent you. This place where we record, it's a bookstore called Shades of Africa in Long Beach, California. They've got a ton of stuff in here. And I mean, the power and the strength in this room. Right now I'm looking at the Hood Health Handbook. I'm looking at Science of Self, Black People Invented Everything, Dick Gregory's Nigger, The Color of Law, Blueprint for Black Power by Amos Wilson. I mean, we got it all in here.
And I'm looking on the other side of the it's like a library, you know. These books are for sale. I'm looking at things from let's start off with Black Panther.
Oh yeah, yeah.
You know, there's
comics.
Yeah, you know, there's a number of things here about Black Panther. I'm looking at Mojo Means One. I'm sorry, Moja. Excuse me, Means One Swahili Counting Book. I'm looking at an alphabet book. I'm looking at Little Legends, Exceptional Men in Black History. Little Legends, Exceptional Women in Black History. I'm looking at Big Dreams for Little Ones. You know, I mean, these are the books that I'm reading to my granddaughter, for God's sake. You know, I'm looking over here, Big Words to Little Me. You know, My Name is Truth. Well, you know who they're talking about, right? Uh-huh. You know, we're talking about Hidden Figures. You know, we're talking about the genius of Egypt and Alice in Wonderland with a brown skinned girl with, you know.
It looks like a very
frizzy hair.
It looks like a very hip hop version. I'm looking at the rabbit there. It looks very hip hop.
Oh, yeah. You know, and others. There's books about, what is this, Millionaire, Lemonade, Escapade. It's a dollar bill on the cover, but, you know, there's a black kid. Little brother.
That reminds me of the little girl, the little black girl that started the lemonade company and became a millionaire.
That's, you know, I'm thinking about that. You know, there's stuff here about Harriet Tubman, Rosa Parks.
Arminta Ross.
That's the name,
right? Arminta Ross. Yeah. That's her real name.
I heard about that. So, you know, by investing in these books and repeatedly, and I do mean that, repeatedly, telling them to our children, we are able to create some of the solution that we've tried to suggest in this particular episode. It starts with you.
And we can't do it without you. We cannot do it without you. So if we've said thank you to the listeners, we've said thank you. Well, we've mentioned where you can get a book. I'd like to also say thank you to Renee at Shades of Africa, because you're doing a great job for us. I'd also to say thank you to our engineer, G Twist.
That's right.
Mr. Twisty, you killing it.
Right. He's a young brother, too.
Oh, yes, he is. Oh. Yes, he is. Young brother out here from Ohio. Ohio in the house. So I think that's it. I think that's it. So we're going to ride out to some Tony Allen. Tony Allen. So for those of you who aren't aware of who Tony Allen is, Tony Allen is the genius drummer who traveled out to Britain or to London and hooked up with Fela Kuti and co-founded the entire musical genre known as Afrobeat.
Afrobeat.
So enjoy
which
this.
Which still lives on today.
Oh, it does.
Yes.
Oh, it does. In fact, Afrobeat is the father of a new genre of music called world music.
Yes.
So just, you know, just understand that jazz changed the entire world, because Afrobeat came from jazz.
Yes.
It came from jazz.
That's very true. That's very true.
We're going to ride out to that. I like you, I love you, and I hope you come back next week. Peace.
Peace.